works. Okay, we're live. All right, Noah's Ark. We finished on Thursday night, Nephilim, Genesis, chapter 6, 1 through 8, which is the precursor to the flood. So if you haven't seen that, that's online. It goes into who the Nephilim are, who the sons of God are, the sons of daughters of man, etc. So we are starting today on verse 9. And what I did is I found that my Berean Study Bible had a really nice translation. So I used that, and we'll compare it to whatever translations you guys have here today. So let's just start there with the first two verses. So Noah, so we just had the precursor, you know, God explains why he's sending the flood. Noah, however, found favor in the eyes of the Lord. This is the account of Noah. Remember the toledots? We talked about how those start big sections. Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his generation. Noah walked with God. And Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. So who was Noah? Well, we know that Noah, based on some descriptions here and elsewhere in scripture, was described as righteous, blameless, and walked with God. So what do they mean? Remember, we talk about terms. We pull out the terms first. So what does it mean by righteous? Well, this is the forensic nuance in which the righteous person or just one meets a standard of right conduct. And in this case, it's the standard of God's right conduct. It's a conduct that exonerates one from some kind of judgment. Generally, when they talk about being righteous, it's in terms of their culture. So if someone is righteous in the times of Jesus, it's someone who's obeying all of the food laws, someone who's obeying the Mosaic law to the letter. Righteous is kind of a cultural term. It's whatever culture we're in, that's the righteousness, right? Blameless, that word is complete or sound. It's this moral uprightness, this integrity in behavior. And we talked before about walking with God, what that means. We talked about Enoch walking with God, and we had the visual of a little child holding their father's hand. You know, they're going on a walk, and the father knows where they're going. The father knows how they're getting there, knows what dangers to look out for, knows what beautiful things to point out along the way, knows how to get the child where they're going to go safely. And the child's only job is to stay close to the father, to stay holding onto his hand, and to stay one step with him, you know, to just one step at a time. And that imagery of walking with God is used pretty rarely. Let me pull up something. Actually, I think I printed it, so I don't need to. I have some extra notes. Okay. So before this, we know that the earth was corrupt in the sight of God, full of violence. God looked on the earth, saw that it was corrupt, for all the living creatures on the earth had corrupted their ways. Then God said to Noah, "The end of all living creatures has come before me, because through them the earth is violent. Now behold, I will destroy them and the earth." Okay, so where are we here? Here we are. Let's go back up to righteous. This is the first time righteous is used in the Bible. And there's this emphasis when it's the first time used, it has this special emphasis in the Bible. This is in reference to righteousness under the Mosaic law, the standard God's character, God's law, being righteous under God's law. And it's the reason that he and his family are preserved, is his righteous nature. He is blameless, moral upright, but that does not mean he's sinless, right? That doesn't mean he's sinless. That just means he's doing well. His eyes are on God. It's God's grace. Bless you. It's like God, it's not that Noah was particularly perfect in and of himself. It was that God had gracefully allowed Noah to be the one he chose. It's kind of this whole, you can kind of look at it as an election thing. Was Noah righteous, or did God reach out to Noah first? Who is first? But I think it's both. You have to have a person has to choose God at the same time that God chooses them. You know what I mean? Like, God allows the grace and you accept the grace. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So he had accepted God's grace and was walking with God. He was not as wicked as those of his day. And you see this juxtaposition of Noah's righteousness versus the men of his day being, you know, evil and dark and sinful. And this antagonism, this antithesis was introduced to us way back in chapter 3, verse 15, with the seed of the serpent and the seed of the woman. So we see that theme continuing down, as is Noah from his generation. It's this idea of he's not following the pack, no matter what else everybody else is doing. Can you imagine? We have each other. We have the Christian church. We have other Christians. Can you imagine if you were literally the only Christian left on earth? How hard that would be. And you were trying to live that out without any pats on the back, without, it wasn't socially acceptable to be kind, to be loving, that was just, things were backwards. Does that make sense? We feel like things are really bad today, but we have each other and we still live in a place that values Christian morals. Can you imagine if that was gone? If evil was celebrated to the point where you were the only one left, I can't imagine. And to maintain righteousness under those circumstances is pretty extreme. That would be very, very difficult. And to lead your family in that and to keep your children from falling away, that would be almost impossible, right? It's the singleness of heart without any apparent reward. You know, when we do good on earth, we socially still get a pat on the back. We still are socially thought of as good. But to live in a world that doesn't value goodness at all would be, to do anything kind for anybody would be extremely difficult, because it would be met with anger. It would be met with hostility and suspicion. He walked with God, as did Enoch. It's that same righteous lineage, both physically and spiritually. We see this. This is following the righteous lineage. This is following the blessing down. And we see that through the patriarchs. We follow the blessing down generation. Who is going to be the one through which the blessing flows? And you get this weird inclusio where it says Noah was a righteous man, and it says some other things. And then it ends with, and God walked with Noah. So you get this inclusio with Noah, kind of, it's almost kind of poetic. It's similar language to the later patriarchs who walked before the Lord, but the only two who are said to walk with the Lord are Enoch and Noah. Do you think those are different distinctions? Is there a difference between walking with the Lord and walking before the Lord? What do you think? Now, lots of questions today, so we're gonna be thinking. Get your coffee if you need to wake up. I brought me Mountain Dew.
With kind of, to me, is like there was like communication, like not just next to them, like it was some sort of communion or connection.
Communion, so. I like that. So you're walking with your friend or you're walking before your friend. Mm-hmm. You're still with your friend, but which is more intimate?
With,
I would think. Walking before somebody almost has this arrogance to it.
Yes.
That's the way I don't know that that's necessarily what they meant, mm-hmm. but in my mind, that's the way I see it. But when we get to that phrase, we'll look at it and see if there's just a difference there. And I want you to be aware of terms that are important. This reflects Adam walking with God in the garden. There's that communion. So Noah found favor or grace in the eyes of the Lord. His faith in God's power to save, that's from Hebrews, through the work of the Messiah to come, was the source of his righteousness. Noah responded to God's grace by obeying God's command. So God's grace comes first. We respond to God's grace by obeying God. Who's the source of our righteousness? Does it come from within us? Never. It's always from God. It's always through obedience and through, we express it through obedience, but it's this faith in our Creator. And it had to be so hard before the Messiah, you know, to trust in God. I just can't imagine Noah's position. You know, he had been passed down this faith. And if you look at, I don't think I have the ages. I have them somewhere. But the ages were such that let's put the lineage up. Let's see if I still have my lineage pulled out. Does anybody have the notes with their lineage so I don't have to pull it out? Put it on here. It's just important to understand. Let me show you. Where was that? Genesis. I have the ages. It's a. Let's just go through desktop. Graceful Answers. Scripts. Old Testament. I want to show you something. Ages. From Adam to Joseph. I don't have to write it on the board if this pops up. Nice. Okay. So we're talking about Noah. So you want to see who was alive when Noah was still alive, right? It's going to take a minute, isn't it? I'll keep talking.
There's something bouncing at the bottom.
Yeah, it's thinking. This computer's just really slow. Okay, so these are the ages from Adam all the way down to Joseph, okay? So remember, number 7 is Noah. And then we see Methuselah here, right? So we have Enoch at 365 years, Methuselah at 969, right? And then Noah. So do you see, oh, it's in your Bibles. Just open your Bibles. That would be easier, right? I like Bible Gateway. Mm-hmm. Genesis, what was the 5?
5.
Okay. All right, so Adam was, let's mark it out. Adam lived 130 and then his son. So you have Adam and then 130 years. Who was his son?
Seth.
We're going to Seth. Right? And then he lived how much longer?
105.
Oh, who will?
800 years. And then another 800. And then Seth lived 105 and became the father of Enosh. How long did Seth live after that?
807.
Thank you. Enosh was how old? 90. 905. Kenan was how old? 70. And 840. Mahalalel. I like saying that one. 65. 830. Jared. 162. He waited a while. 962. And then we have Jared. Don't worry, did Jared. Enoch, 65. Enoch was ready. And then he lived another, how long? 800? No. 365 total. So total 365. And then Methuselah, 187, father of Lamech, a different Lamech, remember. Methuselah was another 782 years. Lamech, 182, he waited a while too. And how long did he live after that? 777, right? Or am I wrong?
A total
of 777. So what do you get here? How long Adam was alive when? Way down here, right? Seth was alive way down here. And then you get, who came after that?
Noah.
Lamech. And then Noah, right? So when Noah, he may be the last man standing, but at least he had a lot of grandparents and great-grandparents and great-great-grandparents alive supporting him, right? Mm-hmm. So I wanted to show you that yeah, he's alone, but they carried it. They were with him, and they passed their faith down somehow through this corrupt world. So, anyway.
But none of them were alive when he boarded the ark.
I think one died 5 years before. We'd have to do the math on that. If someone's good at math, you're welcome.
I did the math a long time ago, and just before they went on the ark.
They were all gone?
Yeah.
They were all gone?
Okay. No. Okay. They were gone. Some of them, there's a school of thought that some of them were there to help them build the ark.
Yeah, I've heard that too.
But then they didn't make it to the ark.
They weren't forced to go through the ark situation, the flood. Because they weren't invited on the ark and they're faithful, they would have been on the ark, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I have heard that they helped build, at least until the end. So, I just think that's neat. Noah was mentioned as one of the three righteous men listed with Job and Daniel. Talk about a list you want to be a part of, right? Mm-hmm. He was included in genealogies in 1 Corinthians and in Luke. I mean, he was remembered. You being in a genealogy, being in part of the lineage of Jesus and being mentioned is a huge honor. He's referenced by Christ. He's referenced by Peter. He's referenced by Paul. He is well remembered. Shem, Ham, and Japheth were his three sons. We're going to look and see who the line of blessing fell through, flowed through. And these are the fountainhead of all peoples. So the question is, who's going to carry the line? And the question here, you know, I dig in, I do the observe, the interpret, and then the apply. Are you walking with God? Are you following the path? Is there anywhere in your life where you are not solely walking with God, but kind of have a toe outside? Are you trusting God in all areas of your life to not just be there for you, but to get you there in the process? Does that make sense? Are you walking step by step? Oh, my mom. I see walking before as meaning doing your own thing, but God's there with you to catch you and help you as needed. We'll see how it's, that's kind of how I see it, but that may be us putting our own vernacular into it, but it is different. It is a different term, and we do need to keep that in mind. All right, let's move on to the next chunk. The next two verses. Now the earth was corrupt in the sight of God and full of violence. And God looked upon the earth and saw that it was corrupt, for all living creatures on earth had corrupted their ways. What do you notice? What do you notice there?
Corrupt is used a lot.
Yeah. What does that mean when we repeat terms? When Moses repeats
terms?
Important. Absolutely. It's an emphasis. What else is repeated?
You know,
look in your version. See if there's something in your version that's repeated.
Violence.
Wickedness. What about earth? How many times is that mentioned?
Yeah.
Do you think there's a connection between humanity and earth? We know there is, because when Adam and Eve sinned, the earth was cursed with them, because the earth is the blessing that God has given humanity. The earth is there as our blessing. And as we are blessed or cursed, the earth is blessed or cursed along with us, right? So it's a complete moral corruption. And that's really hard for us to imagine, because as bad as things are today, like I said, there is still a large church presence. There is still false religions that use Christian morality, right? They borrow from Christianity. Imagine complete corruption everywhere, complete violence. Violence is defined as severe treatment against another person. The defilement of the land is important. Talking about this corruption of the earth. Hey, girl.
Hey.
You ready to come in and talk? Yeah.
Okay. Sure?
Yeah.
Okay. Approved.
Go for it.
I'll come up here. That's okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, good morning, everybody. Mm-hmm. It's like, sounds like y'all are in the middle of something good. If you're in jail, then you're in something good.
Aww.
I'm Karen Roy. Most of you are familiar to me, but I am the Women's Ministry Director here for COVE, but I'm also I have the privilege of helping lead our Fostering Hope Ministry. So we serve foster families and adopted families. Every year at the end of October, there's a move weekend. Are you all familiar with move weekend? Okay, so move weekend is a weekend where we set aside to learn about missions, local missions, global missions, national missions, all the church partners the church has. Usually we have a special service, but part of that weekend on that Saturday morning, we do a 5K. And for the past 5 years, Fostering Hope has been the beneficiary of the 5K, and it really helps fund what we do. So what do we do? So you say you support foster families, what do? So we have about 15 families in the church that foster with different agencies in our surrounding area. We have adoptive families with 3 or 4, maybe more than that. We're growing that side of the care. What we do with those families is each family has an advocate. That advocate communicates with a team of volunteers on the needs of that family. So when they get a placement, we make sure that they get meals. So it's like bringing a foster child in your home is like bringing a newborn baby home from the hospital. Like, it's wild. So we're there to make sure they have meals, to get everything that they need. And as their placement continues, we're encouraging them, intentionally praying for them. You need clothes, equipment, those sort of things. We do that for adoptive families a little differently, but we come alongside them right after placement, even with the international adoptions, domestic adoptions, and then follow them like a foster family for some time, and then our care changes a little bit. So recently, we are seeing a need to add relative caregivers to our groups of families that we serve. You have grandparents caring for the grandchildren, aunts and uncles that get a call that their niece or nephew is going to go to foster care if they don't take them. And so we are seeing that in our church happen more and more. So we're trying to help in those with those families too. So a lot of that side of ministry is run by the volunteers. The volunteers do the meals, they do those things. But the things that our ministry needs funding for are community-wide events. We have touch points with about 150 families in our community that we do play dates for, give them a place of community. We do a big Christmas party. We do education programs where they learn about trauma-informed training and parenting children from hard places. And we have a support group that meets every month. The Hope Resource Center, I think if you were here over the summer, you saw us open the Hope Resource Center. So that is a place where families can come and shop. So it used to just be a storage. We had a closet on the third floor of the Rock Building that grew into a storage unit where we would hold gently used clothing, diapers, wipes, and equipment. Now it's over in like a store. So that is set up like a thrift store. The leader over there, Cheryl, is amazing, and she's very intentional about all the hangers are the same. It doesn't smell like Goodwill. It's like walking to a store where everything's free. And so families can come in and shop. You know, I've met foster teens there, and it's just means a little bit more that they can pick out what they want.
So it's a full family, though.
It's for full family. So the Hope Resource Center started out of Fostering Hope, but the idea is for it, we're working towards it being its own standalone ministry, because the idea is that we grow it into something that can serve any family, all vulnerable families. And we're seeing that. First Coast Women's Services called and they said, hey, we've got stuff for babies up to 12 months, but we don't have things beyond that. And we've got moms coming in here that need help. Can we send them to you? Absolutely. We have had other families come in that they just need some help. And so we've got diapers and wipes and clothing, and God provides, and we have everything we need. They need over there, infant through adult clothing. So that's, and the freezer meals, if you've heard of freezer meal ministry, Fostering Hope supports that. So those meals go to families with new placements or that are having just a hard time, and they throw them in their freezer because we don't want to scare them, like especially a new foster family that's like, okay, this is going to get wild, like you have a lot of people in your house. So put this freezer meal in your freezer and pull it out one day, you know? But that ministry's made, I think, 1,200 meals. So those go out to the community. So it's really an outreach. The intent is to get those families to our church to find support. We partner with other churches in our community that are building foster care ministries. We are closely partnered with the county. We're hosting a child welfare worker luncheon at the end of September to say, hey, we're the church and we love you and we love what you do. So all of that is funded by a lot of the 5K. So this year, more than a 5K race, if you don't want to run it or walk it or stroll it or walk your dog, and we have people that come and just walk their dog. We've added a new 1-mile fun run option for kids 12 and under. It's gonna be in the back field. It'll start at 9, so 8 o'clock 5K. Finish it and take your kids over and let them run the fun five, the 1 mile fun run. We're not really sure what all the details are yet, but it's gonna be fun. And if either one of those, you're not gonna do them, you're gonna be here or you wanna come and just be on the cheer squad. We're gonna have a special section of bleachers for the cheer squad to, you get a shirt and it'll be like squad. Or you can, you know, bring pom-poms and cheer your runners on as they're running the race. So we're trying to make it something everyone can rally around and everyone can be a part of. So I'm joined today by Ian Mowry and Eva Ferris. Ian is part of our Foster and Hope leadership team, and so is Eva. And Ian and James Ferris are really responsible for the 5K, like organizing it and making it extra fun this year. So he's got a couple other things he's going to share. I'm going to pass flyers and stickers out. We have stickers to put on to really spread the word.
Yeah, good morning. So as she mentioned, there's doing some additional fun events this year and some additional things for the 5K. If you want to just come out and cheer on or support in any way. We're also looking for some volunteers. There's some volunteer opportunities out there. Again, there's a link on that flyer just to maybe handle water or you know, run the registration table, assist with the 1 mile fun run for the kids, some volunteer stuff. And then also, if you're interested as a class, maybe sponsorship opportunity there. We're looking for maybe some help getting some bottled water that we can hand out or some snacks that we can make available to the runners. So there's some class sponsorship opportunities there. And corporate sponsorships. If you know anybody that might be interested in sports sponsoring at a corporate level, there's some information here. I'll just leave a couple of these up front. You can always email Karen as well. Her information is on that flyer. But it's going to be a fun event. We're going to have lots of stuff out there. And just if you want to just come out and support in any way you can, we would definitely appreciate it.
Just a couple other things on Fostering Hope. You heard me talk about a little bit about the ministry. We do have a few needs for on our leadership team. As we're growing, we need a foster family advocate, so an advocate that works specifically with foster families, one or more. Like I said, that's a very close role where you're the point of care for that family, checking in on them, making sure they have what they need, communicating to the team of volunteers, setting up a meal train, Sign of Genius. The teams kind of operate differently depending on the needs of the family. Some family needs meals. Some families don't want meals. They just, like a card of encouragement is perfect for them. Or intentional prayer. We meet once a month as advocates, and we pray over the families, and we talk about things that are going on in the different families and how we can serve them best. Another role that we need is a volunteer coordinator, so someone that will help coordinate our volunteers. So when we do these parents' night outs or these Christmas parties and events, someone that's the point of contact for them. But it's also a good discipleship opportunity. You are the person encouraging them in their walk, kind of sharing with them and encouraging them with what they're doing. And then finally, a social media manager is a huge need. If you know anything about social media, it's a bear to take on, and it's good for like one person to do that. So we need some help with social media. So any of those are also ways to get plugged into Fostering Hope specifically. But
wonderful program, y'all. I'm so proud of our church. I'm so proud of
we have an amazing church. Listen, like our church has been so supportive of this ministry, and it's really given us a lot of opportunity in our community to bring people here. I mean, we've baptized foster children. We don't advertise that. But I mean, with their parents' permission, we've done that. And we've had families join the church because of their support through the community. So I'm proud of our church and the way that they've rallied alongside of it and come be with us and cheer people on or walk or listen to Andy's band would be Andy Ferris. Do you all know who Andy Ferris is? Okay, he's the one in the back with the mohawk. Everybody knows him when you say that. So he's like a legend, internationally known. He was just in Scotland, and his band's playing for the weekend. So it'll be a lot of fun. Yeah.
It is a fun weekend.
Yeah. Yeah,
thanks for doing that.
Thank you for giving us time.
Anytime.
Yeah.
Whatever y'all need.
I'll be back to talk about women's stuff.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. I'm gonna sit down now. Okay. So we were talking about how evil the world is and was at that time, how all living creatures on the earth had corrupted their ways, how evil things were, that murder, which is abhorred by God, the innocent blood pollutes the land. And we know this later on in the Old Testament, that the innocent blood pollutes the land, prevents atonement without the murderer being killed. Murder requires atonement. It's very seriously taken by God when you spill the blood of an image bearer of God. And back then in the Old Testament, back in ancient Israel, if there was a murder and they didn't know who did it, whoever, wherever it was, whatever jurisdiction it was in, whoever's town it was closest to took responsibility for it. And they had to make a sacrifice, an animal sacrifice of atonement for that murder if they couldn't find the murderer, because it defiles the land so badly that God can no longer dwell there. So there's this connection there between evil and the land and how it corrupts the earth. Thus, there's all this murder and violence going on. The land is corrupted. God has to cleanse it in some way, or he can no longer dwell with humanity, right? And so God doesn't abandon the earth. God had all the choices, right? He could have just snapped, everybody's dead, start over, destroy the earth completely, start over or not, right? Go do something else with your time. You're God, right? Create a new universe, start a new planet. He could have done anything. But God keeps his promises. And he had made promises to Adam and Eve. He had made promises to humanity that he would bring a Messiah. He would bring a Savior who would fix it. And you've got to realize that by the time of the flood, at least 1,500 years had passed. So a lot of people will look at the flood and go, what kind of God could kill all those people? Those people were killing each other, murdering each other willy-nilly. And he had been graciously patient for 1,556 years. Society today kind of has this implication, especially with the whole evolution thing, that with enough time, society will fix itself, that the next generation will fix it, that we're moving, if we have the right vaccines, if we have the right technology, if we have enough time, we can fix society. This shows us it isn't going to happen. The solution, it doesn't matter what you do on the outside, it's not going to fix the problem that's on the inside, right? It's not going to fix the heart. And so God was very gracious in doing this, and he very easily could have and had the just right to destroy everything, because that's his right. Sin deserves death, right? So what God's doing here is he's cleansing the earth. He's atoning for all of the murder and the violence that had gone on for 1,500 years. And in doing so, he saves the only righteous family that's left. And he didn't have to do that because they're not sinless either. But that was God's grace. And he's holding on to his promise. This shows us God keeps his promises. He made a promise and he's going to keep it. He made a covenant. He's going to honor it. Because that's who he is. People say God can do anything. God can't do anything. God can't do anything that's outside of his character, who he is. He can't lie, for example, right? Because that's outside of his character. So anyway, God saw the corruption, and it was all-inclusive. You've got to really, the all-inclusive, save Noah and his family, that there was this guilt upon, it's justice. All men deserved, all humanity, babies, children, doesn't matter. They were all part of this evil culture that was only evil all the time. It was all inclusive, and they all had this condemnation, and the earth suffers with them. Corruption in their entire lifestyle, their cultural core was corrupt. there was no culture that had Christian values, no moral values, no goodness anywhere. There was nothing that you could lean on, even though, okay, well, they're not Christian, but, you know, at least they borrow our values. No, all values were corrupt. So that gives us a little bit more clarity on why God did what he did, right? So then God said to Noah, so God's speaking to Noah, the end of all living creatures has come before me, because through them the earth is full of violence. Now behold, I will destroy them, both them and the earth. And then he starts giving instruction. Make for yourself an ark of gopher wood. Make rooms in the ark and coat it with pitch inside and out. So he warns Noah. Notice that those that he's walking with, he communicates with. He gives information to. He shares what he is going to do with them. He's walking with them. You understand? As a communion, right? So let's talk about the ark. This is the fun part. So the ark was the focus of a major 1993 scientific study headed by Dr. Xian Hong at the world-class Ship Research Center, KRASO, based in Daejeon, South Korea. So this scientist and his team compared 12 holes of different proportions to figure out which design was most practical. No hole shape was found to significantly outperform the 4,300-year-old biblical design. In fact, the ark's careful balance is easily lost if the proportions are modified, rendering the vessel either unstable, prone to fracture, or dangerously uncomfortable. It was a perfect design. The research team found that the proportions of Noah's ark carefully balanced the conflicting demands of stability, which is that resistance to capsizing, comfort, so that it's not doing this the whole time, and strength. In fact, the ark has the same proportions as a modern cargo ship. The study also confirmed the ark could handle waves as high as 100 feet. Dr. Hong is now director general of the facility and claims that life came from the sea, obviously not the words of a creationist on a mission. He's not a creationist. He wasn't trying to prove anything for us, but in doing this research, he proved the seaworthy nature of Noah's ark. So endorsing the seaworthiness of Noah's Ark obviously did not damage Dr. Hong's credibility. So let's look at this stuff. So God's patience. We talked about this. Noah about the flood. He confides in his friends. God confided in Abraham about the coming destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. Jesus confided in his disciples. And God waited patiently while Noah built the ark. 1 Peter 3:20 says, because they formerly did not obey, when God's patience waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is 8 persons, were brought safely through water. So 8 people we know were on the ark. He waited 1,565 years and 10 generations from Adam to Noah for judgment. So his patience will eventually reach an end, and his patience with our world will eventually reach an end, and we will have the second coming. Justice will prevail. So let's talk about the ark. The ark, Tiba, means a lot of different things. It can mean box, it can mean chest, it can mean coffin. It's the same word used for Moses's basket. And it's a seaworthy vessel. There's, as you would expect, if there is a worldwide flood, right? And then they come together at Babel and then God disperses them, right? What would you expect in those cultures that reject God? There would still be some record of a flood, a worldwide flood, right? Well, there is. There's cultures all over the world spread out that have records of a worldwide flood. The Gilgamesh epic describes it as a cube. And all of these other myths that include a worldwide flood all have flaws in them somewhere that are make it unrealistic. Like Gilgamesh's was a cube. A cube would sink. There's a cube is not seaworthy in any way. But there's little, it's just like if you were a detective trying to solve a mystery, you get, you know, you ask that person and that witness, and you take what's common among all of those to get to the truth, right? Everybody's gonna have a different memory of things, but you take what's common, and what's common to all of them is this Noahic story. This Noahic, don't call it a story when you're talking to people, don't call it we call it a story, but be very careful because that has a connotation of myth. I call them narratives or passages. Language is important. What was gopher wood? We have no idea. Mm-hmm. Some Bibles translate it cypress or pine, but that is because they're assuming that Noah built it in the Middle East. Okay, we know Noah landed in the mountains of Ararat, but did he start there? He's on a boat for a year. He's moving around. It's a violent flood. Plus, we don't know what the world was like before the flood. So we have no idea what kind of wood he used. It doesn't tell us. It doesn't matter, right? But people who try to say they know are assuming that he built it in the Middle East and that the Middle East just happened and he just anchored and stayed right there and then it came back and everything was identical. It doesn't, it's not, we don't know. It was just wood. He sealed it watertight with pitch. It was typical to seal the outside with pitch, but God wanted them to seal the inside too as an extra safety measure. Okay, so let's talk about it. A cubit, we didn't have yardsticks, right? There was no central unit of measurement. Scientific came common to use a cubit, which was your crook of a man, a grown man's elbow to his fingertips, right? This is a common cubit later on in ancient biblical times. When they did major shipbuilding or buildings, they would use what's called a royal cubit, which is this plus four fingers. So it can range anywhere from 17.5 to 21 inches. The common cubit, you usually assume, you'll see your Bible typically will translate it at about 18 inches. The Ark uses a higher measurement because they use the royal cubit, which is actually more likely. So this is kind of using the minimal measurements versus slightly bigger measurements for the Ark encounter that uses the royal cubit, which is more likely. But say we only use 18 inches. That means it's 450 feet long, 75 feet wide, and 45 feet high. That's not a bathtub. This is what you typically see in children's books. And then you've got, you know, the elephant with his nose sticking out and giraffe coming out the top, and they're all falling out. And no wonder our kids growing up thinking this is impossible.
Yeah.
Because that's still in their mind. When they hit college and people start asking hard questions, we need to show them what it really looked like, right? So we need to show them how big it really was. Displacement of about 24,000 tons, 1.4 million cubic feet, something like that, could fit 522 railroad cars, 125,000 sheep, or 18,000 species. So it was the size of a modern cargo ship, and it needed to withstand violent waters. Now, when we think of things like waves, out in the middle of the ocean, those waves don't really rock the ship that much, right? It's not till they hit land that things like tsunamis are problems. The problem is going to come from the wind. That's where the waves are going to come from. And God sends a great wind to wipe everything down, right? That's where things are going to be bad. It's going to be a deep water voyage, and the worst waves are going to be from the wind, right? Normally that'll cause breaching, right? Where the ship turns sideways into the wind and gets knocked down. Anybody who's been to the beach knows when a wave comes, you turn sideways. You want the skinniest part going into the wave, right? So what are they gonna do? What are they gonna do? So let's go here. So here is an example. I pulled this from that article. I did a lot of research on the Ark. The design that God gave Noah was perfectly balanced between comfort, stability, and strength. See how for maximum comfort, it needed to be long and skinny. For stability, it needed to be wide. And for strength, it needed to be deep. So combining the midpoint of all of these things gets you right smack in the middle of the measurements that God gave Noah. Fascinating. Let's talk about the window. All right. Any opening on the deck of a ship needs a wall or a combing. This is a combing to block the water, right? To prevent water flowing in, especially when the ship rolls. Okay. In this illustration, the window ends a cubit upward and above. That's from Genesis 6:16. The central position of the skylight is chosen to reflect the idea of a noon light. So let's look at the where the skylight would be here. See in the middle, mm-hmm. how they would open up the skylight there to let the light in on a nice day and to let smells out. This also means that the window does not need to be exactly one cubit. Perhaps the skylight had a transparent roof, even more of a noon light, where the skylight roof could be opened, which might correspond to when Noah removed the covering of the ark. There's lots of variations, but they've combed through and figured out what most likely was or what could have been, trying to figure out if this is even a seaworthy vessel. And what they've discovered is, yeah, not only is it a seaworthy vessel, it's a brilliant design. So how do they avoid breaching? How do they avoid turning? This long ship is going to turn sideways facing the wind, facing the wave and get rolled over, right? Well, broaching can be avoided if a vessel catches the wind at one end and is rooted in the water at the other end. So you'll see that's like a sail, right? So it catches the wind and this roots it to keep it going straight into the waves. And this was a common shipbuilding technique for the ancient Greeks. So it's, I mean, we don't know that Noah wasn't a brilliant shipbuilder of his day. We don't know that later ships weren't designed based on what they remembered from the ark. We just know that it's possible. This shows that it's possible, right? It had no need for speed, but it did move about on the surface of the waters. So a large sail-like structure is not for propulsion, but that plus the rigid bow fin would catch the wind and turn the stern into the waves, similar to the way wind turns a weather vane. In addition to a bow fin, a kind of skeg or large fin-like projection at the bottom of the stern would restrict side motion, keeping the vessel rotated to face the passing waves, called a following sea. So to prevent sagging and hogging on the large wooden vessel is the main challenge. So Tim Lovett from Answers in Genesis proposed that Noah could have built three keels running lengthwise along the ship's bottom. So down here, there's three like sticky outy things. Normally you have one on a ship.
You like my technical terms. Normally a ship is like that, right? Because I got speed. He didn't need speed. He needed stability. So if you got three, far more stable.
Okay. So three massive beams, along with an intricate system of sturdy timbers running up to the roof, would allow the ship to counteract the tremendous stresses of a long voyage. Having three keels instead of just one, which is seen on most ships today, would also allow the ship to be constructed without supports and then to remain upright after it landed. So what about the danger of the planks sliding? Wood ships have their own issues, right? So what about the issue of the planks sliding? So here's another picture of the stern and then the bow fin, just to show you. And then we've got the size here, just to give you kind of an idea. I mean, this is just so much more logical than the fishbowl, or even a square or the rectangle that you used to see. Someone thought this through, and you don't think God's gonna think this through? You don't think Adam's gonna figure it out? If we could figure it out, if Answers in Genesis could figure it out, you know, over a few years, you don't think Adam or God and Noah could have figured it out? So here is an, the Noah's Ark is about as big as wooden ships can be. After that, you need steel ships for sizes that big. But this gives you an idea of how big it is compared to steel ships. So it's about as big as a wood ship can be, but it's within the size limits of what a wood ship could be. Okay. Now let me show you something really cool. Plank sliding. Lovett realized that skilled shipbuilders knew how to design a multi-layer covering for the hull. So you've got multi-layers on the hull. The outside layers are sacrificial, right? Those are going to get knocked into stuff. They're not necessarily for structural integrity, but to absorb blows from obstructions and wear away without damaging any of the underlying layers. He borrowed this design for the strakes from ancient shipbuilders. The Greeks and the Romans became masters of the sea because they had perfected a technique known as mortise and tenon planking. Mortise and tenon planking. See here, your mortise is your hull and your tenon is your, this part.
The peg,
yeah. And so it slides into there and it provides stability. And then when the water swells the wood, it's even stronger, right? So this was a brilliant innovation. The interlocking pieces kept the ships tight by securing each plank, right, to the planks above and below it. Chinese vessels from the 1400s used multiple layers of planking. Each successive layer of planking dramatically increases their resistance to stress. Both ancient and modern shipbuilders of wooden ships have used another technique to prevent leakage, which Noah easily could have used. They pound wooden pegs called trunnels into holes drilled into the strakes. Along with holding the planks in place, these trunnels also swell when the ship is in water, providing an extra measure of waterproofing, right? So these trunnels stab through this way, so you have it going this way, you have it going this way. You've got some extreme stability. The Bible specifically says that God instructed Noah to coat the inside and the outside of the ark with pitch that would have waterproofed it, right? Throughout history, builders of wooden ships have done this on the outside to prevent leakage, but the internal pitch would have provided an extra barrier against leakage. And depending on when it was applied, it may have even acted as a preservative during the extended construction period. Because remember, he's working on this for a long time. Okay, so you guys have any questions about this chaos? But I think this is really cool. This is a very cool illustration of one way that Noah could have very easily built a ship-worthy or seaworthy vessel. He had the time. We don't know that he didn't have the expertise. You know, there's gods involved, so why not? So it's possible. People say it's impossible. It's not impossible. We've shown how it is possible. All right. Let's see what time it is. Okay, we're getting to the end. Okay, so this is how you're to build it. Ark is to be 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, 300 cubits high. You're going to make a roof for the ark, finish its walls, a cubit from the top, place a door on the side of the ark, one door, we'll talk about that, and build lower, middle, and upper decks. So remember back, where was that picture? There. Ramps were likely used for ease of getting animals up and down, for just, it's easier to build that way. Ramps were likely used to distribute food and water and to get rid of waste. So they figured out where they only really needed to feed the animals once a week and clean up their waste once a week. They figured out a way to do it. I don't know. Right?
If you guys go to the Ark Encounter, mm-hmm. it's amazing. It shows like the whole detailing on how they did the waste. Because that's the question I always had.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, what do they do with that, right? Yeah. How do they do that? Yeah. How did eight people deal with all that? They yeah. showed. It's so cool. You can go on their website. Answersingenesis.org. Answersingenesis.org. I spend so much time on that website anyway. .org. And
so
then,
the website you just mentioned? I went to the museum. So
there's a museum, yeah. Answers.tv is another great place where you can just access. I think it's a for fee or there's some free. You can get most of their stuff on their website or on YouTube. Just look up Answers in Genesis. But Answers.tv has tons of shows for your family and tons of documentaries on how they did all this.
What is it?
Christian Best?
Answers.tv, yes, absolutely. Absolutely, very. Okay. Behold, I'll bring the floodwaters upon the earth to destroy every living creature under the heavens that has the breath of life. Everything on the earth will perish, but I will establish my covenant with you. You will enter the ark, you and your sons and your wife and your sons' wives with you. Okay, I'll just go ahead and read this so we're ready for next time. And you're to bring two of every living creature into the ark, male and female, to keep them alive with you. Two of every kind of bird and animal and crawling creature will come to you to be kept alive. And you're to take for yourself every kind of food that's eaten and gathered as food for yourselves and for the animals. So God did everything precisely as God had commanded him. Okay, so when did the flood happen? Well, according to the timeline, somewhere around 2348. That's a good guess. Let's see what this one says. Oh, it doesn't give the, this is the date that I found. Was the flood global? I've got videos you guys can watch on this that show that the flood was absolutely global. 7-4 and 23 all say that every living thing was destroyed. That implies that all life on Earth was destroyed. 7-19 says that all high mountains under the heavens to a depth were covered to at least a depth of 23 feet. So what happens when water is higher than the tallest mountain? Can it be local? Doesn't work that way. Water will flow. And then they came to rest on the mountains of Ararat, which is a mountain range that reaches over 16,000 feet. Didn't say they rested in the foothills. They rested on the mountains. And then God promised never again. If it was a local flood, he lied. Because there's been plenty of local floods.
True.
So we'll talk more about fossils. We'll talk about the canopy and the hydroplane theory on Thursday. Jesus attested to it. Ezekiel talked about it. Isaiah talked about it. Peter talked about it. So if you are a Bible-believing Christian, it is impossible not to believe in a global flood. Not if you look at it for half a second. So
well, didn't you say that there's different accounts in different
cultures? Oh yeah.
So, I mean,
tons.
Even if you're not a Bible believing Christian, there's still a historical account.
Yeah, there's tons of historical all over the world. I mean, I have it here somewhere. I'll go through all this. Tons of evidence for the flood. Here's other flood traditions. There's like over 200. All the way in Egypt, Greenland, American Indians, Mexicans, Peru, Greek, Hindu, Chinese, Polynesian, Babylonian. Druids, I mean, it's all over the world, which makes sense, right? Because the people are going to spread out.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's going to be history of a global flood. And these histories include things like one family being saved and it being God that did it and the animals. I mean, there's different tidbits of the truth throughout these. It's fascinating.
And they try to say that the Bible takes from the Epic of Gilgamesh because the record proves that Gilgamesh was written before the biblical, but they're not taking into account the oral.
Right, the oral tradition having been there long before. Yeah.
That Noah's oral tradition did
come
before.
Absolutely. And Noah's tradition is actually logical and makes sense. And it's presented as a narrative. It's presented as history. It's given, you know, you're given dates and years and details that are consistent.
Are
very
down.
Mythical. Yeah. They're very much like once upon a time kind of stories. So anyway, so I'll post some links to some videos to watch since we didn't get to do that in class today. I forgot we had a presentation coming in, but check the Facebook page. If you're not on Facebook and you want to be included in this thing, send me an email. Here, I'll put it in the chat. Graceful Answers Ministries at gmail.com. And I'll send you links. I think I spelled that right. In a world religions class in college, the flood is repeated throughout different religions, Mom said. Shaylin said, this was so fascinating about how Noah built the ark. I was late to this live, but I'm impressed. Oh, that's very sweet.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Shaylin. I appreciate you being here. All right, guys. We're going to end it here, and I'll see you guys on Thursday at 8:30.
Thank you.